All right, so we're gonna actually start the damn paladin holy shock guide. There's just so much to say about it. I had to do a 45-minute video on just like the setup and the preamble. But this is actually the guide. So here we go. So we're gonna talk about why these runes are so amazing to take. So let's look at your jab really fast. So imagine a situation where the enemy is trying to run away from you, right? And they are about 10 yards away from you. And you can actually predict what your DPS looks like based upon how far away they are from you. So if they're like 13 yards away from you, that means you're able to judge them on cooldown. You're able to holy shock them on cooldown. And, of course, you're pelting them with exorcisms. If they're 20 yards away, you get to use holy shock and exorcism. If they're beyond 20 yards away or beyond 23 yards away due to leeway in the game, then all you have is exorcism. And we're going to look at what does your judgment damage DPS look like? What does your holy shock DPS look like? What is Sheath of Light doing for you? All that stuff. I'm actually paused the video to spare you guys all the math on subject here. But we'll do exorcism here really fast just so you can see what it is. She does 550 damage base. If you have Sheath of Light active and you're properly geared, go see the first video. You're going to have about 440 spell power, but you're probably going to also be using a spell blade, which is going to increase that by like another 200 spell power. So you're going to have, we'll say about 650 spell power. Exorcism only has a 40% spell power ratio behind it, so we only get to take 40% of that. And you can see that all the spell power you have going on is going to increase Exorcism DPS by about 50%, which is not bad. But that's the power of Spell Blade. That's the power of Sheath of Light being active on this build. Anyways, I'm going to go, And then, of course, you have Fanaticism. And with Holy Power, Fanaticism, and then, like, you're standing, like, you know, 15% critical strike chance for spells or whatever the heck it is. I'm going to assume you have, like, a 30% melee critical strike chance, so I would have to literally add these together. So it would be, like, plus 550, and then we'd multiply it by, like, by 115 for 15%. Why? Because we only do plus 50% damage when we actually crit them. So, voila, you'll do like 930 damage. And of course, you divide it by the cooldown, which is 7.5 seconds, and you're doing 124 DPS. What the balls? What you're basically going to see in the TLDR here is that SOR judgment with a bunch of spell power behind it, and exorcism with a bunch of spell power behind it, and then purifying power is going to do well over 200 DPS against your target, which is terrifying because that's the amount of damage that you would physically do from bitch slapping them in melee without Divine Storm, right? Like I said in the previous video, I'm intimately familiar with the DPS needs and the DPS amounts. You with a Flurry Axe and Seal of Righteousness, you do an Avengers and no runes whatsoever. You're basically doing, because you end up having a Judgment of the Crusader on them, you end up doing about 200-ish DPS against a 40% armored target. This thing gets to do 200 DPS to a target that's 13 yards away from them and refusing to be in melee. If the thing actually does end up in melee with them, it's the stuff of nightmares, because out comes Judgment of Crusader. Then you're just sitting on them for a length of time. You're divine storming them. You'll swap out of your one-hander into a two-handed weapon just to bitch slap them and divine storm them. Then you go right back into the one-hander and you keep pelting them with spells. You get an extra, like, you know, 200 plus holy damage on them because you get to put Judgment of Crusader on them. If you actually get into combat with them, your DPS is going to spike to, like, 500, which is just the stuff of nightmares. And that's on a build that is the tankiest thing that you can possibly be, and it actually has chase capability while you're pelting the enemy. But again, that's only at the 13-yard range. But even at the 30-yard range, as you can see, you're doing like 100 and damn near 130 DPS to the enemy, while all they can do is run away from you in a straight line. This is terrifying. Okay, but I'm going to pause the video here, and I'll get all the numbers here really fast. Alright, let's see what we got going on here. Okay, so, this 224 holy DPS, 30-yard range instant spell cast, that is Exorcism, doing basically what Exorcism does best. This 90 DPS over here is your Judgment of SOR. Both of these are you using a spell blade, and you, naturally this is a Shock Eye Paladin build. Hopefully you can see it behind here. Or basically, you get Holy Shock, and you also get Eye for an Eye. But you're also down here for the improved Judgments. So this is on an 8-second thing. So you can see your Judgment does a terrifying amount of damage. Your SOR does a terrifying amount of Judgment damage. Your Exorcism does an insane amount. Like I promised you, it's well over 200. And this is Holy Shock. And Holy Shock doesn't really do anything for you. Like, at all. She's kind of like hot garbage. This is one of the reasons why I start comparing the Holy Shock build to the Reckoning Paladin build, she just doesn't really stand up all that well. Reckoning is Holy Reckoning is just objectively superior to a Holy Shock Paladin build. Because I keep looking at Holy Shock and scratching my head, and it's like, okay, well, without Art of War and all that stuff, she's just not viable. But you're just, even without Art of War and all that stuff, you're still, absolutely amazing anyways. So it's like, why the hell am I taking Holy Shock as opposed to Reckoning? Cause I could get both of these things and Reckoning at the same time, but it's like, whatever. Holy Shock does start looking a bit better when you look at her, from a defensive and a burst, a perspective. So, for example, if I was to do the math on all this stuff at, say, 30 seconds, right? Like, okay, what does my DPS look like in 30 seconds with all these spell casts? Holy Shock would look significant. She'd basically double, right? She would basically times two to, like, a 48 DPS. These would get a little bit of front-loaded stuff in them, and it just starts looking pretty damn good pretty fast. I can do that here for you guys really fast. All right, so, divide by two, times two, doesn't really matter. 48, times 30. Yes. Yeah, because you're doing 30 seconds of DPS. So this is your Holy Shock damage. That's how much damage she'll do for you within 30 seconds. It's like, whoop-de-effin-do. It's basically nothing. This one will do 90 times 30. No. It's actually... Actually, I just do that, don't I? Yeah. 90.5 times 38. Because one of the spell casts is front-loaded. Yeah, she'll do... what the fuck is wrong with you? Come on. 90.5 times 38. Okay, yeah. So she'll do 3,440. 3,440. Plus equals... Fuck off. What was the other one? It was like 1,400, 1,450. Yeah. I don't care anymore. I don't care. All right, so she does 1,450. She's like 3,4... 40 equals, yeah, okay, so we're getting somewhere now. And then Exorcism, of course, is absolutely fucking nuts. 124 times 37.5, because there's a front-loaded one in there, yeah. Literally almost a doubling in the damage. Literally ridiculous. Okay. All right, so in 30 seconds, this paladin, without hitting anybody in melee... without any additional anything going on, just for spell casting alone, we'll do 9,540 damage, which is not bad. Exorcism is actually doing about 1,400 of this, which isn't the worst thing in the world. You can see that once you start factoring in like a divine storm with a two-handed weapon on the close. So for example, you pelted them with spells, you know you're going to hit them pretty soon, so you swap over to a two-handed weapon, get the two-handed weapon hit in, you get the divine storm hit in, you immediately go back to a spell blade and start blasting them again. You start factoring in Seal of Righteousness with a fast one-handed weapon in all this stuff, and I can actually do that really quickly here. Stuff is just going to be the stuff of nightmares really quickly. My point is, you have more than enough DPS likely to get the job done. There's only a handful of classes in the entire game that can suffer 200 DPS being pelted into them while running away at full speed. Okay, so what I'm trying to describe here is that your DPS more than doubles when you make melee contact with the enemy, but even if you don't make melee contact with the enemy and you're just chasing them at about the 13-yard range mark, your DPS is still terrifying. It's like a 210 DPS. It's well 215 DPS. It's well over 200 DPS. Okay, which is terrifying because how many classes do we know of in the game can suffer 200 the attention of 200-ish DPS while running away at full speed? The answer is Druid and nobody else. Like priests are gonna die to that. Pretty quickly, mages are going to crumple, shamans are going to die, almost everybody and their dog at some point is going to have to stop and heal themselves, and when they stop and heal themselves, they get introduced to the times 2 pushback of Seal of Righteousness, they get introduced to Edward the Odd, they get introduced more than a doubling of your DPS because now you're physically on top of them with Seal of Righteousness. Even without Divine Storm, being physically on top of somebody with Seal of Righteousness will give you about 200 DPS. With Sheath of Light, it's probably closer to like 240 DPS. I can do it real fast if you want. Your base, you're going to have about 440 spell power, and you're probably going to judge Crusader Strike on them because you've identified you're going to be sitting on them for a while. Lord knows they need to try to out-heal your DPS, so you might as well make it worse. So you're going to gain, like, you know, about 220-ish spell power from a Judgment of Crusader. So even though you switched from a spell blade, potentially, to a Flurry Axe, you're still going to be, you know, blah, 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 blah. Some spell blades are 1.5 weapon speed, which actually aren't half bad. That might be your best one-handed weapon in the future. So I can actually, but I don't want to calculate that really quick because it'll change the DPS of Exorcism, it'll change the DPS of your Judgment and all that stuff. And Flurry Axe is probably equal in damage between a Flurry Axe or Edward the Odd, a Spellblade, to be perfectly honest. Edward the Odd's probably better, Flurry Axe might be better, or they're just equal. You're not going to get anything for a 1.5 speed Spellblade. Okay, whoo. All right. Now I have to basically take 20% of this, because that's SOR. And then SOR, the max rank is like 22 on Flurry Axe. I know that. Yeah, so your Seal of Righteousness is doing 155 damage per hit at 1.3 weapon speeds. Yeah. So now I have to take this, and that's on top of the damn white damage. So now I need to take this and divide it by 1.3 to get DPS. So SOR is doing damn near 120 fucking DPS, which is terrifying. And, of course, there's white damage involved. And you're an Avengers-geared paladin with, like we said before, you've got 700 attack power and 20% melee critical strike and blah, 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 blah. I already know what that is off the top of my head because I invented time on target. It is what it is, right? You actually do, if I recall correctly, let me think. I know it's 150 with Might of Minithil at these stats. Without the critical strike chance factored in. But Might of Minithil is like 90 damage, and Flurry Axe is like 47 or something like that. So I think I have to minus 50 practically. Yeah, so it's about 100 DPS versus a 40% armor target, you know, blah, 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 blah. You're probably only gaining maybe, it's probably like 75 DPS. And then, of course, we had, what was the other one? Damn near 120? Yeah. So, just a rough mathematical estimate, you're probably doing about 190 extra DPS against a 40% armored target just because you are using SOR. So, that's without Divine Storm alone. Point is, your DPS is going to double. The sheer act of you being in melee with them is going to double the DPS. So, they have to try to run away from you. And if they're trying to run away from you, you're pelting them with Exorcism at a minimum, at a whopping, like, you know, 124 DPS. At some point, they're going to have to stop and heal themselves, unless they're specifically a druid. The only one that might be able to out-sustain that, maybe, is a priest, because they can put up their Power Word Shield, and they can put a Hot on themselves. Lord knows there's runes out there where you can probably put more Hots on yourselves. Shamans have, like, Earth Shield and stuff. So maybe your enemies can deal with the Exorcism DPS, but they're definitely not going to be able to deal with the Exorcism and the Judgment DPS, which is a problem. The other problem here is that they're running away for very good reason. They're running away so they can try to heal up or get mana or get out of combat or wait for cooldowns of some kind. But while they're at it, they might as well heal up, right? And Exorcism alone is just stopping them from doing that. Really scary stuff. So your chase actually isn't that bad. And believe it or not, the Holy Shock DPS being added in there isn't the worst thing in the world. So if you're stuck at like the 23-yard range mark from the enemy, what this means is you can't judge them for damage, which sucks because it's minus 90 DPS. But you can Exorcism them and you can Holy Shock them. And at that point, Holy Shock's, plus 24 DPS is not the worst thing in the world. Like, it's not half bad at that the medium range mark. It's about 150 DPS at the medium range mark. So it's very interesting. So your chase as this type of paladin is not half bad at all. And I want to point that out. When you physically get on top of them, your DPS spikes extraordinarily, which means that you have a good chase. Now we have to examine durability, because that's the only other element for, like, this jousting, time on target, hybrid style. What the hell is jousting, you might be asking? All right, well, jousting is, I grenade you, I grenade stun you for 3 seconds, I run over there, I bitch slap you for like, one GCD, you come out of the grenade stun, you grenade stun me back, and then you run away, like, you know, 27 yards in those 3 seconds of stun. And then I come 3 seconds later, I come out of the stun, you're 27 yards away from me, and then I have to chase after you at, like, you know, the 27-yard range mark. And all I have to really do, traditionally a paladin wouldn't have anything to do. The correct course of action for us at that point is to Gnomish Netomatic you and just catch back up to you again and start giving you the business. Or be a Reckoning Paladin, which means that if I touch you even once, you just died. You know what I mean? Those are basically your only real options. The Deep Rep Paladins have Repent to play with, which causes... But there's just this jousting effect where it's like, I use X to catch you. I get to smack you once. Then you use the exact same thing to get away from me. It resets to being about dead even. I stun you to catch you. I hit you once, you stun me to run away, we trade back and forth, but there's this, it's called jousting because there is this little bitch slap that happens in between the two events. Yeah, but so the joust will activate Sheath of Light. We'll activate the Sheath of Light, and then when the enemy runs away from you, they're at the 27-yard range mark, or they're doing whatever the hell it is, you start running after them, except now you can keep bitch-slapping them with, like, 150 DPS. Well, it would be 124 DPS at the 27-yard range mark. If you can get closer, your DPS gets even better. If you can get closer still, it gets even better and better and better. And there are ways to do that as a paladin. It's actually very, very common in a lot of combat sequences. Just gotta take my word for it, where the enemy is just within judgment range or they're just outside of judgment range and you're chasing after them. And under those circumstances where they're just within judgment range, but you can't quite get melee hits on them, this is where this build basically goes Super Saiyan. But it does have the joust, which means that when you physically make contact with the enemy, you do get to bitch slap them with, you get to do terrible things to them, right? So if I grenade the enemy, what do I get to do while I'm running at them? Well, I get to exorcism them with a spell blade. I get to switch to a two-hander to get its cooldown going. I get to run over there and bitch slap them with a two-hander and divine storm on them, and then switch to a spell blade. Then I get stunned and they like run away. I get to also judge damage on them. Then they run away from me, and it's like, well, they took like and then of course they took one exorcism, one judgment, one two-handed auto attack, and one divine storm, and only now are they getting away from me, and now my sheath of light is active, and I'm pelting them with exorcisms. It's a good time, it's good stuff. Okay, so on the durability side of things, you are the most durable paladin while still maintaining DPS that you can possibly be. The reason for this is because you have both Sacred Shield, Hand of Reckoning, and Sheath of Light. So Reckoning doesn't take Sheath of Light. They take Enlightened Judgments, and the only reason they don't take Sheath of Light isn't because Sheath of Light isn't God tier. They're taking Sheath of they're not taking Sheath of Light because when a Reckoning Paladin touches something in Season of Discovery, it dies. So there's no point in taking a spell where it's like a rune where it's I touch you and I gain spell power. Whoopty fucking do, you already died. It's like that would only be really good in like a mosh pit environment where I have to kill this guy and then turn around and fight this guy. It's like it'd be like the 1v(x) scenario is the only scenario where you'd actually want Sheath of Light. So if I was in Battlegrounds as a Reckoning Paladin, I'm taking Sheath of Light, but under normal circumstances, I'm not taking it. But it is God tier if you do take Sheath of Light in conjunction with Sacred Shield. And it's super, super God tier if you take Sheath of Light in conjunction with Sacred Shield in conjunction with 3 out of 3 Healing Light in conjunction with Divine Favor at that and in conjunction with Holy Power. At that point, your durability is going Super Saiyan to the nines. Why is this? Because at any time, you can free crit heal Holy Light yourself for, like, you know, 3,700 HP, or like 70% of your HP pool. What's worse is that guaranteed Holy Light critical will activate Sheath of Light's thing and heal you for an additional, like, 2,000 hit points. So, like, another, you know, whatever the heck that is, like 40% of your life. Over the course of 12 seconds, meaning you now have this 12-second window where you are not only full life, but you have this insane hot on yourself, making you incredibly hard to kill. If you've never played Time on Target Paladin before, you'll know that free crit heal from Divine Favor is worth its weight in gold, because it's one hell of a tempo play. There's this weird thing with Time on Target Paladin where there's only two ways for the enemy to get a Time on Target Paladin off of them. The first way is for them to use Hard CC, which we tend to counter by using Hard CC ourselves and just building in certain ways where we have like a 50% chance to resist grenade stuns. So for example, you'll be in like full tier 2 with like a fire resist setup, and you'll be using Hand of Rag, and the next thing you know, you have 500 fire or 200 fire resist, which is a 50% fire damage reduction and a 55% chance that goblin mortar and grenades just don't stun you anymore, which is terrifying when you catch people with grenades and or goblin mortar, and then they try to get you off of them with grenade and goblin mortar. One of those is going to statistically fail, and then you're just sitting on them for a very uncomfortable length of time, basically just murdering them or just grinding them into pulp. So you do that. What's the other one I'm trying to think of? Right, so that's the one way to get us off of us is to trade CC with us, which we're basically designed to counter. And then the only other way to get a Time on Target Paladin off of them is to do enough damage to them to force them to start healing. This is why you're using things like Edward the Odd, because when it procs, it's basically a full life heal. This is also why your free Holy Light critical heal is super, super valuable, because it lets you catch them with a grenade and then make your way over to them. And then you get to if their stun whiffs or they're out of grenade stuns, then you just get to sit on them for an uncomfortable amount of time until they do enough damage to get you physically off of them. But once it starts looking like they might do enough damage to get you off of them, you just hodge stun them for 3 seconds because it's on GCD, right? or it's on diminishing returns. But in those 3 seconds, you can get out a guaranteed Holy Light critical to heal you for 70% of your life, which means that you're still physically on top of them for an uncomfortable amount of time, thunking away at them with an Edward the Odd that has basically has statistically, it procs like once every 25 seconds. And when that thing procs, it's basically a free Holy Light heal, which is terrifying. And then you're just sitting on them for even longer periods of time because they can't physically get you off of them. So it's super valuable for you to be able to heal yourself while physically on top of the enemy. And the free crit heal is a massive tempo play, especially in conjunction with a Hammer of Justice being only 3 second duration. Super, super amazing. You start giving me Sheath of Light on top of that, and I'm like, what the balls? What do you mean I have 12 seconds where I'm basically healing myself for another Holy Light while I'm basically bitch-slapping this guy? That's amazing. And then on top of that, you have Sacred Shield. And you're like, what the hell do you mean I have Sacred Shield? Sacred Shield is absolutely insane. It's basically a flash of lighting me. It's basically worth a flash of light every, like, 6 seconds. That's insane. And then you start looking at the Sacred Shield's, 50% increased critical strike chance, and the fact that it puts another hot on you whenever you flash of light yourself, and you start adding all this stuff up together, and it's just like, damn, you're gonna be sitting on your target for a million years, and not a damn thing you could do about it. It gets worse with Hand of Reckoning. The reason why we're taking Hand of Reckoning is when I drop bullet, not only is it, burst damage protection. It's worth about 10% increased effective HP for surviving bursts. She basically is a king's buff, but better for the purposes of not dying to insane amounts of burst damage. But more importantly, whenever you drop below 35% life or around about there, your healing effects are increased by 25%. Which means the Sheath of Light hot is increased by 25%. The Sacred Shield Flash of Light healing hot is increased by 25%. If you have any kind of trinkets going on, or Edward the Odd is increased by 25%. If you're judging Judgment of Light into the target, which you have 3 out of 3 lasting judgments, and you can 100% do that, that's increased by 25%. So your durability is just absolutely effing insane. And it's wonderful. Beautiful, wonderful, adorable. And so this just lets you sit on the enemy for like a million years. You're super tanky under all circumstances, right? So if you're heal locked, you're insanely tanky. If you're closing on the target, you're insanely tanky. Your standing HP pool is absolutely insane. Even if you do get chunked down to like 20% life, you just stun them and say, hold my beer and heal for 70% of your life and get this stupid hot on yourself for another 40% life heal over 12 seconds, which is just nuts. Sacred Shield is there for you. Holy Shock is there for you for healing. Holy Shock is almost always better used to heal yourself than she is used for DPS purposes, but not always. And then you kind of sort of have this jab thing going on that you can use in the background, talked about in the first video, right? Where you can make spell casts take like 1 second longer, and so you can close on targets that want to stand their ground and try to hard cast spells or sheep you or whatever the hell. She's a jack of all trades, master of none. The only thing she's the master of is she's the most durable paladin build that you can possibly have. She's second in durability only to Holy Reckoning. I would still say she's not quite as good as Holy Reckoning. Holy Reckoning is probably still objectively better than this deep Holy Shock paladin build. But if you play the damn thing, you're probably not even going to notice. She also has Eye for an Eye, which is absolutely insane. Very good for the joust. Very good for the reflect damage. If you don't know the reflect damage from Eye for an Eye, it takes like a fraction of a second to bitch slap back at the enemy, especially if the spell has like a travel time to its target. And that damage can cause spell pushback. It can do terrible, terrible things to the enemy, like eat up grounding totems. Super, super good stuff. Eye for an Eye is also just amazing damage. Eye for an Eye is literally like Reckoning against spellcasters, but better because it causes annoying spell pushback a lot of the time. Or damages their bubble shields and whatnot and lets you close with a joust much better. I like this build. This build is really good. The only thing really questionable here is, since we're so durable, do we need Hand of Reckoning? Can we take Crusader Strike instead? I don't know. Do we need Divine Storm and to switch out with this or that or this other thing? Or can I just, like, you know, take Horn of Lordaeron? Or can I take, you probably don't want to take Seal of Martyrdom, but you could if you want to. Or do I take Aegis? I personally think that for jousting purposes, you're better off with Divine Storm. And I think for durability purposes, you're better off with Hand of Reckoning. But if you find yourself not needing all that durability, you can just pick up Crusader Strike and you'll just end up doing even more damage when you're physically on top of the target. The point is, if you're stuck in melee with the enemy, you're insanely durable and you're going to be happy to have a Divine Storm in a lot of matchups. She's not the worst thing in the world. If you're forced to chase the target, you actually have really good chase DPS, especially since you have Holy Shock available to you. Your push back on the chase is not the worst thing in the world, especially if you start factoring in Eye for an Eye and you start factoring in your critical strike chance with Exorcism and all that stuff. It's not the worst thing in the world. Against most enemy spellcasters, you actually do have a good chasing joust. Chasing jab. But against very specific classes like mages, you might struggle to try to prevent the sheep before you get into melee with them. But usually you counter that by just using PvP trinket and bubble. And what you do is you basically run up to the mage and you judge damage on them and you exorcism on them and then you get turned into a fucking sheep. And then you just, like, wait for the cooldown because the mage has to run away for 6 seconds before they can drop combat, start eating and drinking. You just wait those 6 seconds out, and then you PvP trinket, and it's like, oh, look, have a Holy Shock. You're staying in combat with me, and then they have to try to sheep you again, and then you exorcism them, except now their sheep is, you know, because they don't have the shield up anymore. Their exorcism is, or their sheep is now a 2.5-second cast, rather than a 3-second cast. I mean, rather than a 1.5-second cast, and, oh, look, I can easily cover 27 yards in that amount of time and bitch slap you, and, oh, look, I have Divine Storm and a two-handed weapon, so enjoy this bitch slap, and you basically double auto-attack them with a two-handed weapon, and they turn you into a fucking sheep again, and at this point, you don't even want to know how low life this mage's health bar is. He's taken damage from Eye for an Eye. He's been pelted by exorcisms. He's finally gotten a sheep off on you, only to watch you PvP trinket it, and like, and to Divine Storm and bitch slap him with a two-handed weapon, and to exorcism, and to get another judgment off on him, like, what the fuck, right? And he ate a Holy Shock to the face. This is not a happy mage, and then he has to do it all over again, where he, like, runs away for 6 seconds, tries to eat and drink, and you could just bubble this damn thing away and start pelting his ass again. This is not a happy mage. And then when bubble finally wears off, and he's like, fuck you, I'm going to finally get this sheep off on you, now you're grenading him and goblin mortaring him and shit, and you're still pelting his dumb ass. At some point, the mage's health bar is going to drop below 20%, and at that point, you don't even have to press W towards him anymore. You can just run away. Why? Because you can hover at the 30-yard range mark, back up if he's trying to sheep you, pelt him with exorcisms on cooldown, and weave in Hammer of Wraths. Absolutely terrifying. The mage is going to die. So you end up killing the mage in a very weird kind of jousty, grinding style combat, if that makes any sense. And of course, Sheath of Light and Sacred Shield and Hand of Reckoning are doing spectacular under those conditions. So I don't really see very many weaknesses with this build. The only super weakness about the build is that you don't have Reckoning. The advantage to it is that you have Eye for an Eye. So here's the trade-off, right? Holy Reckoning has all of the durability increases that Holy has, minus Holy Shock. Right, so you have the free crit heal in conjunction with Sheath of Light. You've got Healing Light. Maybe you don't even use Healing Light. You use the Lasting Judgments as the Holy Reckoning Paladin. But you don't have Eye for an Eye. So you end up having better matchups against, like, Rogue and other melee classes. Hunter comes to mind. But you have weaker matchups against spellcasters because you don't have Eye for an Eye. And you certainly don't have Seal of Command. That's the other thing, is that because we put 1 point in Seal of Command, we can actually a Seal Twist if Divine Storm is on cooldown for whatever reason. which again starts raising the question of why the hell are we taking Divine Storm when you could take other things like, you know, Horn of Lordaeron or Aegis, because we did take Seal of Command so that we have the Seal Twist. It's like, why am I Divine Storming when I could just Seal Twist out of command? And the answer to that is, well, Divine Storm is at least more reliable. And on number one, Divine Storm is more reliable. And when we actually do end up in a time on target scenario with the enemy, it's actually kind of nice to have both Divine Storm and Seal of Command. That way we can actually, you know, sit in... Well, what would happen at that point would be you would swap out of your Spellblade or your one-hander into a two-hander, immediately Divine Storm, and then you're stuck holding that two-hander until you can swing that two-hander on cooldown before you can go back to the one-hander. Well, in that period of time, guess what? Your GCD is going to come off a cooldown, and you can actually Seal Twist SOR into Seal of Command, right? So that's why we're both taking Divine Storm and we're taking Seal of Command instead of something else, because when we actually are in those time on target scenarios, we can double dip on the effect. No, she's just really good. Eye for an Eye is actually really good. You're also a damn holy paladin, so if you ever find yourself fighting enemy melee classes, put on a damn shield. Under those circumstances, Divine Storm isn't going to be super great, because you're basically going to be wearing a shield against rogues and against warriors and melee hunters and melee shamans most of the time. But because you're a holy paladin with Sacred Shield, Hand of Reckoning, and Sheath of Light, and Fanaticism, and everything else going on, it's not going to be as dominating of a performance against those melee classes as Holy Reckoning would be, or Ret Reckoning would be, or Heal Reckoning would be, or even Deep Ret would be. But you're probably going to do better than Deep Ret, and you're just basically going to beat them to death over time. A combination of your durability and the constant pelting of spell DPS on top of SOR and Edward the Odd and everything else you got going on is just going to crush. With your sheer durability, it's just going to crush enemy melee classes into the dirt, basically. So I'm the end of the video here, and Deus Vult boys, this was a nightmare and a half to try to figure out from a tactical perspective, from a statistical perspective, like, you know, what's best, blah, 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 blah. I promised you I would do the phase 3 stuff at the end. In Phase 3, we don't have access to our Avengers gear, our all-stats gear. Blizzard is still dicking around with our PvP gear as if it's retail, which is really sad. You want spell power plate gear, right? With just stamina, intellect, spell power, nothing else. That's what Paladin wants, right? No! The answer is effing no. What are you, stupid? I don't have spell power ratios. I don't even have spells. Go away! So it's terrible. The jousting paladin in phase 3 is the only way to go. The Art of War paladin is 100% not online right now at all. And even if she was, the jousting paladin is probably objectively better, unless you're specifically, dueling against, very specific classes. So if it's an enemy melee class, the Art of War paladin is going to be the best thing since sliced bread. If it's any other type of class, like a spellcaster, it's basically worthless, and you wouldn't want to take it. Your Abyss gear for the Jousting Paladin, is probably the Spell Power gear, but I could be wrong about that. It's really hard to tell. The Plus Healing gear isn't the worst thing in the world. You have Sheath of Light. Let me think about this for a second. Yeah, okay. So, since this build has Sheath of Light, you probably want to wear the same gear in Phase 3 as a Deep Ret Paladin. So, if we go and we look at the... If you go and look at the Reckoning Guide, I basically compare the two Paladins together. I conclude that this is the best gear what I'm trying to explain here is if I swapped out all this gear to be like the pure attack power gear, my mana bar would drop by like 1,000 mana. It would end up being like 1,800 mana. And then this HP pool would go up to like, you know, 4,400 or something stupid like that. And attack power would go up and spell power and blah, 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 blah. Your gearing for that paladin probably isn't the plus healing gear. The Reckoning Paladin uses a plus healing gear. Since you're using Sheath of Light, I would suggest using a mix of plus healing and spell power. So specifically, whatever gearing here is plus healing would get swapped out for spell power gear. Nope, turn that off. We don't want that. Wailing leg plates, Blanish knights. I think it's Lamellar. Lamellar has always been the spell power. Yeah, so we'd switch out legs. You can see our HP isn't going to change all that much. Actually, our HP went down significantly, and I don't know why. That's weird. Let me go double check. Now I'm very confused. Emerald leg plates? No. Fuck off. Scroll down. Okay. 15 compared to 12. Lamellar. Imbued leggings. Yeah, shouldn't have dropped. I don't know. Am I stupid or something? Maybe I'm crazy. Should be 3,700. That's really weird. Oh, maybe I used some other kind of like piece of gear here that was pretty good. Yeah, that's probably what happened. Now I'm just like, what the balls? Block value of my shield. Stamina, intellect. Whatever. Meh. I have no idea what happened. What the fuck? What is going on? You see this? Oh, is it a set bonus? Oh, it's the two set bonus. Okay. Thank God. Right, so the best gearing is to actually double dip on the two set bonus. You completely ignore the six set bonus. So you can see I have a three set bonus here for plus 15 stamina. And if I scroll down here, I have the three set bonus for plus 15 stamina. Boots, gauntlets, and pauldrons are the best strength stamina pieces. You're going to wear those regardless of whatever what paladin build you're doing. This Reckoning Paladin build is using a spell, a plus healing setup, but there's a good chance you're going to want to be using the spell power gear instead. So we're going to go Lamellar, and then I have to go find the other Lamellar bits. Yep. Lamellar, and then Knights Imbued. Yep, and then Lamellar. Lamellar, Lamellar, Lamellar. 3-step bonus? Okay, cool. So our HP is up to normal. Our mana is up to normal. There might be some bits here. Yeah, the healing done might get swapped out for some actual spell damage. Let's try to find that real fast. Damage and healing and 9 stamina. Hell yeah, we'll take that. Anything else that needs to be replaced? Not particularly. Damage and healing, 9 stamina, improve your chance to get a critical strike, 1%. I have no idea. Where's the spell power? Increase damage and healing, but it's got no stamina on it whatsoever. Ooh. Me no like. Chance to hit with spells and attacks. That's not the worst thing in the world, because this doesn't have... I guess you do put points in prot. At level 30. Mark of a car? Yeah, we're taking this. Yeah. Because the 10 strength is going to give us a fair bit of spell power, and then we just have more stamina. We like spell power. We like stamina. Yeah, so this is pretty much what it's going to look like. I want to remove the plus healing for... whatever. Anyways, I don't want to get too far into the weeds with this, because I'm destroying my personal reckoning build. But as you can see, we're basically swapping out all the plus healing gear for spell damage gear. Your spell damage isn't going to be that high in the grand scheme of things. Like, sitting there butt naked, you might have, like, maybe 70 spell power at most. But what's important here is that you actually have a decent amount of attack power. Attack rating, no thank you. Yeah, you got 400. You're going to have about 450-ish attack power. Depends on what... like Blessing of Might and all that stuff and blah, 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 blah. Because you don't have kings in this build, so you might as well use Blessing of Might. I imagine Blessing of Might improves this by like 120 at level 50 or something stupid like that. And then I get to take 30% of that, and I get to add 70% for standing spell power pools. So you're at about 250 spell power. To put this in perspective, the Deep Retribution Paladin has about 300 spell power and then more stamina than you do, so you might end up wearing the exact same gear as the damn Deep Ret Paladin. It's really hard to tell. Yeah, he had about 300 spell, it wasn't spell power, it was more like plus healing and spell power, because he had a bunch of strength gear on him. It's very weird, so I'm finding it interesting that this is only 241, but I guess that's spell power, and there's still a bit of plus healing gear on this build for some reason. I have no idea where it is currently. I have no idea who, because you're only giving me 22, so you, like, why is this 55, and this is like 143? What the hell is going on here? Oh, it's the enchants. Derp? Interesting. Alright, spell damage and healing, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Okay. The point is, just gear. I haven't looked into the gearing too terribly deep. Again, the theory crafting is very fresh. But you're going to want to have a high stamina pool. As you can see here, this means you're going to be wearing a mix of spell power and then melee critical strike, or just melee attack power gear, because you do have Sheath of Light. You're going to want to play it as a jousting paladin, blah, 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 blah. If you had plus healing gear on here, I wouldn't lament it too much, but math is just, because Sheath of Light, you're going to have, you're going to want the attack power gear, basically. It just has more stamina on it. Even though you probably don't need the stamina, so she's really weird. It would take me a long time to figure out what the ideal setup for this thing is. I know the Reckoning Paladin was perfectly happy with 3,750 HP, and then it had like it doesn't have Sheath of Light, so it only has like 200 plus healing, but it does have Sacred Shield and Reckoning and everything else, which is funny. But she jabs with Exorcism and she jabs with Seal of Martyrdom. So spell power is less important on her than it is for a Seal of Righteousness jab. But yeah, Seasoned to Taste, you're going to be the tankiest thing in the entire game. What do talents look like at level 40? Okay. Well, you've only got 10 extra talent points to play with. So to be perfectly honest, you're probably just putting... you're probably literally just doing this. And that's it. And nothing else. You're probably just reducing the cooldown on your judgment to 8 seconds, because putting the 10 talent points anyplace else just isn't worth it. So you take Holy Shock and you get improved judgment, and you just call it good. And that's basically all you have to play with right now. And of course, the runes are the same as we've been talking about. But this video is getting quite long, so I'm ending the video here, and Deus Vult, boys. Deus Vult, boys.